this morning with my mind stayed on Jesus. Woke up this morning with my mind stayed on Jesus. Woke up this morning with my mind stayed on Jesus. Hallelujah.
Good morning. Welcome to Beneficent Congregational Church, United Church of Christ. Welcome on this 19th Sunday after Pentecost and this Generosity Sunday when we will dedicate our pledges for 2021. Welcome to people of all colors, sexual orientations, and gender identities and expressions, all body shapes and sizes, all ages, and everywhere along the spectrum of physical, mental, and emotional health and well-being, because you are here. This body of Christ is whole and perfect. I am Pastor Elizabeth, and what a blessing it is to be together as church this morning. We'll continue our worship now in song.
Shall I
please join me in the words of gathering. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? One thing I ask of God, what will I seek after? That will I seek after, to live in God's house all the days of my life, to behold God's beauty and to inquire in God's holy temple. For God will shelter me in the day of trouble. God will conceal me under the holy tent. God will set me high on a rock. I believe that I shall see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait for the Lord, be strong, and let your heart take courage. Wait for the Lord. Let us open our hearts in prayer. O Divine One, may our worship be done in companionship with you. May our worship sing praise to you as songbirds do. May our worship add to the light of your presence, because it is done with great love. We come to you, beloved, with ready hearts. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you, and also with you. Let us greet one another.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning. Good morning, Pastor Elizabeth.
Good morning, everyone.
Oh, Sheila, I want to be where you are on that beach.
Right on the beach in Massachusetts, so I'm back in New England.
Yeah! Okay.
Hi,
Sheila.
Morning, folks.
Good
morning, Michael.
Good morning.
Good morning. And for those to whom it applies, happy National Coming Out Day.
Come on out.
Wow. Good morning.
Good morning, Valerie. Good morning. Where's Miss Joya?
Good morning, Joya.
Say good morning.
Hi. Good morning, Joya.
She is stirring some pumpkin muffins.
Oh, that sounds good.
Morning, Luigi.
Good morning, Joyce.
Good morning, John.
Good morning, Richard.
Good morning again.
Look, there's our church.
Good morning, Jane.
Say good morning.
Good morning, morning, Rachel.
Good morning, Jen.
Good morning.
You want owl? Okay, let's go owl. Good
morning.
Well, let's move into our announcements. If you would please mute yourself. If you are new to Beneficent and joining us for the first time, welcome. Send us a message through our Facebook page or email us through our website, beneficentchurch.org, and I'll reach out to say hello and we'll send you the e-newsletter every week. This afternoon at 3 p.m., join us for the joyful, spirit-filled celebration of Pastor Germain's ordination. A link is available in our bulletin and in the weekly e-news. Joshua Maria Garcia, our youth and young adult educator, has announced that the college-age Bible study known as Current is expanding to include young adults ages 18 to 30-ish, so Gen Z and millennials as well, and they're meeting at 6 this evening, so check it out. There are lots more announcements in your worship bulletin and in the e-news, so give those a glance, and we'll continue worship now with our mission moment with Kenny Alston.
Okay. Shall this, yes? This is working and you can see. So I decided a couple things, right? Some of you, if you've been in church for a while, you've seen me up here before in Mission Moment. And I was probably wearing a suit because it's kind of like a second skin for me. But I thought I'm gonna do something a little different, a little masterpiece theater. I've actually got a light up here, a friend of mine rigged up to make me look even more smashing. And so with that, we set off. I've been thinking a lot about words like perspective and frame and lens, context. And I've been wondering why, And then I came to the conclusion that I actually know exactly why. Because it's 2020. This is a year unlike any other year, I think it's safe to say. And of course, every year is different. But I think we all know that 2020 is really different, right? I'm not gonna even go through the many ways in which 2020 has been different, except to say, I happen to work for the Rhode Island Department of Health, and it has been, completely bonkers from the first, and there's no sign really of stopping. So that's really setting the stage. And I thought back in terms of context, like remember the end of 2016 after the election, and it was really a terrible, if you're the sort of People magazine reading, award show watching person that I kind of wish I weren't, but probably am. You know that 2016 had a multitude of awful celebrity deaths. The worst was, for me, George Michael, who shall rest in power until I get to heaven, so we can sing a duet, finally. Prince died in 2016. Okay. So lo and behold, here comes 2020, looking like the dog's breakfast, which is a phrase that I've borrowed from a colleague. It's been insane. It's been very difficult. It's been very hard for lots of people for lots of different reasons. And so with that frame in mind, I ask myself, what can I say to really impress upon folks, at least for me personally, what this journey has meant for me, what belonging to this church has meant for me, what being a member has meant. And it really is about context, right? when I am not, well, we've all been, right, searching for ways to stay tuned in, to stay plugged in, to stay connected. And some of us are better than that than others at that, I have to say. It took me a while to adopt this form of service because I kept telling myself, it's gonna end, it's gonna end, it's gonna end, I'm gonna go back to church, I'm gonna go back to church, I'm gonna go back to church. And then at a certain point, I realized I miss this family too much, right? So so we make deals and bargains with ourselves and compromises, at least I do, to feel plugged in and to feel connected and to feel like I belong. And this is the only church where that has ever been true for me. And I've said it before, it takes the whole person. You know, we have a pastor who welcomes you in the morning on Sunday by telling you, because you're here, this family, this body of Christ is perfect. And I think that that sums up exactly everything that I want to say about why it's important for me to be here and why the context matters. Context also matters, as a matter of fact, in terms of generosity and stewardship and pledging. We are a couple weeks into the campaign, and I think it's fair to say that we are not exactly where we'd like to be. So I would encourage people, first of all, to there are ways to, in the bulletin and other places online, and I believe that Gordon included an insert to tell people how to pledge online, which I am going to do today or this week as well. And I'm going to increase from last year. So if you feel okay about doing things online like I do, that's the way to do it. I've also been told that there will be hard copy pledge cards sent out to the entire church body. So if you would prefer to do it that way, that's fine. Those cards will be coming to you in the mail. You'll soon receive them and you can sign up for, well, for both. You can certainly, donations of money are always accepted because money is, it's important. You know, there's no getting around it. And in this year, 2020, it's particularly important because we don't want to lose the momentum that we have gained over the last year or two. And we want to keep moving. If I had more time, I'd talk about some of the amazing things that this church does outside of the walls of the church, what we do in the community. It's not something that we always talk about a lot or even brag about. And that's probably fine to not brag about it, but you should at least know about it because it's being done in your name. And those things are wonderful. I think that that is all that I wanted to say. So I want to remind you to stay connected, stay tuned in, pledge, please, your time, your talent, your money, and I will see you next week and the week after that, and probably the week after that at Beneficent. Thanks.
Kevin, children's moment?
I seem to have lost you all. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Oh, okay. Actually, I am going to defer my children's moment to another week. And stepping in this week is our wonderful Amy Santiago, who has a beautiful message for us.
Good morning. Good morning, beneficent family. Did you ever throw a party, a birthday party, or a holiday party? Well, my son, when he was young, and we threw family parties, he wanted to invite everyone. And not because he wanted lots of presents, but because he wanted to share everything good with everyone he knew. He wanted to share the goodie bags and the treats and all the food with everyone. I mean, everyone in the neighborhood and all his friends. Well, God is like that. God wants to share all of the love. God wants to share all of God's wonderful creations with all of us. Unfortunately, we don't all listen. We don't all hear God's call. And I know that we want for all of our friends to share in God's love. Sometimes it's sad for us because we have heard God's message. We want to share that message. We want all of our friends to feel God's love. And what we can do, we can pray. We can pray that all of our friends, all that we know, will share in God's love. It can be upsetting when we see our friends hurt others. It can be upsetting when we see the pain that God's love can heal. But we pray. We pray as hard as we can. And when we don't feel God's love because of the pain in the world, we can pray for ourselves. So our prayer for today, I'm going to share with you. God, I pray that I may see something good in every person, even one I dislike, and that I may let God develop the good in that person. Thank you, beneficent family.
Jesus wants me for a son, me to shine for him each day. In every way, try to please him at home, at school, at play. A son, me. Jesus wants me for a sunbeam. I'll be a sunbeam for him.
I'm Lucas. This is a reading from the Gospel of Matthew. Once more, Jesus spoke to them in parables, saying, "The kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who gave a wedding banquet for his son. He sent his slaves to call those who have been invited to the wedding banquet, but they would not come. Again, he sent other slaves, saying, 'Tell those who have been invited, look, I have prepared my dinner. My oxen and my fat calves have been slaughtered, and everything is ready. Come to the wedding banquet.' But they made light of it and went away, one to his farm, another to his business, while the rest seized his slaves, mistreated them, and killed them. The king was enraged. He sent his troops, destroyed those murderers, and burned their city. Then he said to his slaves, 'The wedding is ready, but those invited were not worthy. Go, therefore, into the main streets and invite everyone you find to the wedding banquet.' Those slaves went out into the streets, gathered all whom they found, both good and bad, so the wedding hall was filled with guests. But when the king came in to see the guests, he noticed a man there who was not wearing a wedding robe, and he said to him, 'Friend, how did you get in here without a wedding robe?' And he was speechless. Then the king said to the attendants, 'Bind him hand and foot. Throw him into the outer darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are called, but few are chosen.'" Here ends the reading.
Thank you, Lucas. Will you all pray with me? Oh God, my words are only seeds. It is your Holy Spirit that plants them. May it be so. Amen. A king throws a lavish wedding banquet for his son. But when his slaves go out to summon the guests, they won't come. One has work to do on his farm. Another has business to attend to. The others give no reason for declining the king's invitation. So the king sends his slaves out again to bring in whoever they can find, good or bad. They drag people in off the street. The banquet hall fills up with a happy jumble of people, and the feasting begins. This is an old parable, and we find it not only in Matthew, but also in Luke and in the apocryphal Gospel of Thomas. Beneath the surface, it's an allegory. The wedding banquet represents the messianic banquet, the great heavenly feast where all the faithful will gather at the end of time. The king is God. The son getting married is Jesus. The original guests are the people of Israel, and the first slaves are the Hebrew prophets who cannot persuade the guests to join the banquet. The second slaves are the Christian missionaries who bring both the good and the bad into the banquet, extending the table of God's love to Jew and Gentile alike. This is the parable as we receive it from Luke and from Thomas, simple, straightforward. But this is not how we receive it from Matthew. Matthew adds a few bizarre twists. Some of the guests abuse and murder the servants who come to fetch them. What's up with that? Matthew is referring here to the Christian missionaries who were martyred in the church's cause, but it doesn't quite line up because the first slaves represent the Hebrew prophets, right? Then the king responds to those murders by murdering the murderers and burning down their city. This is Matthew's nod to the burning of Jerusalem in the year 70, though it makes a hash of the allegory. The king is God, is Rome? were Matthew tweeting out this parable today, we might wonder whether he is tripping on dexamethasone. But actually, he's trying to adapt an older parable to historical events that come much later after the death of Jesus. And truth to tell, all the gospel writers do a little of that. But hands down, the weirdest plot point Matthew adds is when the king encounters a guest who's not wearing proper clothes and demands to know, how did you get in here without a wedding robe? Naturally, the guest is speechless. Isn't it obvious? He was pulled off the street by the king's own people wearing, well, street clothes. The king orders them, bind him hand and foot and throw him into the outer darkness where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. This makes no sense. And Lord have mercy on this poor underdressed guest. But again, Matthew is bending the parable to deliver a bit of advanced Christian theology that was conceived after Jesus died, not before. Here's the theology. When the risen Christ returns to earth at the end of time, there will be a last judgment with a big cosmic sorting of sheep and goats, and only the good guys will be carried up to the great messianic banquet in heaven. And Matthew puts the cherry on top with a signature tagline, "For many are called, but few are chosen." I am enchanted with this last little tweak, where a wedding guest is kicked out because he hasn't packed a robe. You remember Mahalia singing last Sunday, "I got a robe, sing with me. You got a robe. All God's children got a robe, my Lord. When we get to heaven, gonna put on our robes." And we're gonna put on our robes, friends, because we're going to the great messianic banquet. That's what the song is about. We'll get a standard issue heavenly robe. So we can what? So we can shout. Yep, we're going to be doing some shouting. Let's talk about these robes. Elsewhere in the New Testament, there are references to clothing ourselves with something. Romans 13, "Let us then lay aside the works of evil, reveling and drunkenness, debauchery and licentiousness, quarreling and jealousy. Instead, put on the Lord Jesus Christ." Galatians 3, "You who were baptized into Christ have clothed yourselves with Christ." Colossians 3, "As God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, clothe yourself with compassion, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience." Now remember in the parable of the prodigal son, what did the father give the son to wear to symbolize his atonement, his restoration to the family? The best robe in the house. And three different passages in the Revelation to John refer to the righteous being given or wearing spotless white robes. Raise your hand if you were baptized by immersion. I was. What were we all wearing? White robes. In the early church, new converts to the faith, people who embrace Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, are often described as putting on a new set of clothes. It symbolizes giving up a worldly way of life and putting on a new Christian life. This is making Mabel crazy. Can you see what she's doing? So what does this say about our dressed down guest who is thrown out of the banquet? It says, when you accept an invitation, it's not enough just to show up. You need to pack a robe. You need to clothe yourself in readiness for what lies ahead. Let me illustrate. When I teach the new member orientation here at Beneficent, I tell people about all the good things you will receive when you join the church. We provide opportunities to bring our cares and troubles and joys to God and get some help putting what happens to us into a larger context. That is worship at Beneficent. We provide opportunities to learn about the historic Christian faith, to study the Bible, to enlarge our awareness of what is happening in the world. That is education at Beneficent. We provide opportunities to form lasting friendships, to meet people, to lean on in times of crisis, people of like mind with whom we can have the sorts of conversations we may not be able to have at home or in the workplace. That is fellowship at Beneficent. And finally, we provide opportunities for Christian service in the church, in the community, in the world. That is mission at Beneficent. When you join the church, you get all these opportunities. And in exchange, we ask only one thing: sincerity. We ask you to put on a robe of sincerity. Sincerity first in your attendance. When we're going through a rough time, we really need Beneficent to be there for us. And then when the crisis passes and things are going better, we need to be here for other folks who are taking their turn having a crisis. From each according to our ability, to each according to our need. We also ask sincerity in relationships. We are so diverse here in our religious beliefs and backgrounds and cultural contexts, and we have to bear with those differences. We try to practice clear communication, transparent process, and healthy boundaries. We have a relational covenant, and we try to follow it. And there are even times when we are called upon to value the welfare of the whole congregation more than our own personal needs and desires. We ask sincerity in conduct. We are all trying to live our lives as best we can in a Christ-like manner. We're trying to live in honesty, integrity, forgiveness, and justice, to do what's right. We ask sincerity in learning. We each try to grow beyond our borders, add to the sum of who we are, read our Bibles, take advantage of adult education and children's Sunday school, stay informed about current events. Finally, we ask sincerity in giving, treasure, time, and talent. I tell every prospective member exactly how much money I give to the church, and I don't mind telling the rest of you. I pledge 5% of my gross annual income to Beneficent. This year, that's $4,500. Next year, I'm increasing it to $4,800. I give extra whenever we have a special offering, and I give to other organizations outside the church. I'm not saying this to impress you. This should not impress you. You should expect this of me, maybe of yourself. When we accept an invitation, it's not enough just to show up. We need to pack a robe. At Beneficent, we all are asked to robe ourselves in sincerity. Sincerity and readiness for whatever God calls us to be and do. Do you remember Stone Soup, that folk tale about some hungry travelers who convince people to share a little something from each of their pantries? They end up making a big pot of soup large enough to feed the whole village. There's a variation on Stone Soup that has been making the rounds lately. One person says, "I have carrots." Another says, "I have celery." Another has onions, another parsley, another garlic, and so on. Finally, A small child steps forward and says, "I don't have anything." Someone responds, "But do you have a spoon and a bowl? There's enough for everyone." At Beneficent, there's enough for everyone. If you leave your robe behind some days, crumpled in the back of your closet, that's just fine. Sometimes all we can do is come as we are with our spoon and our bowl. But whenever we can, let us clothe ourselves with sincerity. Let's pack a robe. Amen.
Beautiful robe, so white. Beautiful land, so light. Beautiful home, so bright. Where there shall come no night. Beautiful.
Brother Ernest, thank you, Pastor Elizabeth, for that beautiful message, beautiful robe. It's so good to be back in the house of the Lord, even if it's virtually. And I know many of us wish that we could be together, like you said, Kenny. But you know, we are here. And a lot of people didn't make it to see October 11th, 2020. Yesterday was World Mental Health Awareness Day. I know many people are struggling during this time of the pandemic, just dealing with isolation and loneliness. And so that's one thing I want to lift up in our prayers today. If you are in need of prayer, or if you want to petition or lift up someone in prayer, please utilize the chat function. You can also send it to me directly, and I'll put in my personal prayers this evening. Yes, and just be open to what God is going to do in this moment. I pray for healing across our land, and I pray that we can be restored how we were before. So let us pray. Oh, gracious God, we come to you saying thank you before we ask of anything. We thank you for allowing us to be here once again via Zoom, at this place called Beneficent Congregational Church. God, we thank you for the leaders. We thank you for the individuals who have sojourned here, all the members, everyone who plays a role in this wonderful ministry, God. We ask that you touch those who are in need of a blessing. Touch those who are in need of a breakthrough. Touch those who are struggling mentally right now with depression, with anxiety, with fear. Bring comfort and peace to them right now, Lord. We ask that you touch those who are in need of a special blessing. You know what they go through. You hear the silent tears at night, God, that they cry, God. So we ask that you comfort them. Send your loving angels to protect them from all hurt, harm, and danger, God. We ask that you bless this country. We ask that you watch out for those who are in the midst of Hurricane Delta in the Gulf and Louisiana specifically, who have been battered and torn by so many storms this year and it's only October, God. We're praying for our brothers and sisters in California who are still battling wildfires, Lord. We thank you for all those immigrants who have been caged and locked up like animals, who often goes unnoticed. Let the world see that they are human and that humanity should supersede politics, God. God, we know that we are going through a turbulent time within our country, God. I ask that you bring peace in your land. Heal us from racism. Heal us from sexism. Heal us from xenophobia, Lord. God, we ask that you touch us. Touch our land. Help us to make wise decisions regarding our future leaders, Lord. Let them walk in wisdom so that they may run this country and that may be more equitable for everyone, not just the privileged, God. We ask that you touch the poor. Touch those who are in need. Touch those who are mourning. Well, we know that so many people have lost their lives because of COVID-19, God. And as cases continue to rise, we ask that you just bring comfort to those who may be sick and battling the disease, God. And we touch those family members who are dealing with the loss of a loved one, whether it's from COVID or was it from any other disease, God, or ailment, God, strengthen their hearts. You see them, you know them, Lord. And God, I ask that you give us a sense of joy, in this season when so many people are down, disheartened, distraught. Help us to find joy in the midst of sorrow, in the midst of pain, in the midst of confusion. And remind us that you are still on the throne, that you are looking down on us, and that you have us on your mind, God. Now, God, we ask that you teach us how to pray like you taught your disciples. Like Jesus taught his disciples. Our Father, Mother Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Let the church say amen. Let the church say amen. Let the church say amen. Amen. Amen.
Jesus said, "Do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust consume, and where thieves break in and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, for where your treasure is, there will your heart be also." Just as our hearts belong to Beneficent, let us also entrust our treasure to Beneficent. Let us bring forward our offerings and our 2021 pledges.
Down, shake it together and run it over. Give and it will come.
Mercy and grace, whose bounty has blessed us all, we thank you for this opportunity to contribute to beneficence work in the world. We dedicate these offerings, these pledges, and our very selves to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
As I went down in the river to pray, studying about that good old way, and who shall wear the starry crown, good Lord, show me the way. Oh, sisters, let's go down, come on down. Oh, sisters, let's go down, down in the river to pray. As I went down in the river to pray, studying about that good old way, and who shall wear the robe and crown, good Lord, show me the way. Oh, brothers, let's go down, come on down. Come on, brothers, let's go down, down in the river to pray. As I went down in the river to pray, studying about that good old way, and who shall wear the starry crown, good Lord, show me the way. Oh, fathers, let's go down, come on down. Oh, fathers, let's go down, down in the river to pray. As I went down in the river to pray, studying about that good old way, and who shall wear the robe and crown, good Lord, show me the way. Oh, mothers, let's go down, come on down, don't you want to go down? Come on, mothers, let's go down, down in the river to pray. As I went down in the river to pray, studying about that good old way, and who shall wear the starry crown, good Lord, show me the way. Oh, sinners, let's go down, come on down. Oh, sinners, let's go down, down in the river to pray. As I went down in the river to pray, studying about that good old way, and who shall wear the robe and crown, good Lord, show me the way.
The worship has ended. The service begins. May God watch between you and me, while we are parted one from another. May Christ stay beside you and me while we are parted one from another. And while God is watching and Christ is staying, may the Holy Spirit be abiding until we meet again. Amen.
I I got a role up in that kingdom, in that good news.
See you all at 3 o'clock.
Amen.